Welcome back to Off-Grid News, our take on the on-grid world. And today, why we need off-grid villages. Think about it for a moment, and a sharp increase in the numbers living off-grid, currently about 75 to 100,000 in the UK and over a million in America, would fulfil a whole raft of policy objectives. With housing facing multiple crises of affordability and supply, and in the case of social housing, of funding and allocation, off-grid settlements offer an important new alternative. They can help solve three problems: cheap housing, how to enable it; energy security, how to improve it; and rural regeneration, how to kickstart it. Policymakers see it as too weird or fringe to support off-grid initiatives, but they are being too timid. In America, there has been a sharp rise in the number of households off the grid, from 500,000 5 years ago to over 1 million today. In the crowded UK, growth is slower, inhibited by soaring land prices and the planning permission system. But there are encouraging signs. Here at Off Grid, we're involved with the plan to turn a defunct coal mine into an off-grid village. And a new factory in South Wales is producing solar-powered gadgets of every conceivable sort. Back in 2007, I set off around Britain in a camper van to meet the people who are living this way and wrote a book about it called How to Live Off-Grid. I visited deep green protesters in Devon, inner city unemployed near Sheffield. But the most interesting communities were in Scotland and Wales, where slightly different laws and a greater tolerance of social experiments has spawned a handful of success stories. Then, the main motivations for living off-grid were ideological. Either ecological, about taking personal responsibility for reducing carbon and water consumption, or alternatively a weariness with consumerism, a desire to spend less and consequently a need to earn less. But the following year came the banking crash, and interest in off-grid living grew sharply, although the motivations had shifted. Then, and still now, the feeling was that one might have to look after oneself, that the state and politicians could no longer be trusted with our welfare in the event of a social or economic or environmental collapse. Separately, the numbers who were going off-grid because there was simply no other affordable option also increased. In 2010, I repeated the trip around, and this time in America, where conditions are far more favourable for off-grid living. This time, my drive led to a book which inspired thousands to try the off-grid life for themselves. Back in Britain, because of the planning obstacles already mentioned, the fastest growing segment of the off-grid community are those living on urban canals and rivers. In London, where I once wrote about a couple of dozen narrowboats moored in Springfield Park, Hackney, there are now hundreds, perhaps thousands, along the Lee Valley and all the way into Broadway Market in South Hackney, where the liveaboard owners run bookshops and cafes to cater to the landlubbers who flock to the area. Many attracted to the low-cost way of living in one of the world's most expensive cities. If the government's housing czars and energy strategists want a quick win, they need look no further than supporting two or three experimental off-grid communities. At relatively low cost, they could quickly create thousands of homes in rural areas plagued by unemployment and depopulation. These communities would have a lower carbon footprint than the average, and I believe that the houses would be cheaper to produce, partly because they would not need the grid brought to their door. Also, because the rooms would be significantly smaller than in a typical home, since off-grid designs incorporate the understanding that heating and maintenance costs are lower in smaller buildings. Living off-grid is labour-intensive, and that in itself would generate some jobs. Food production and the turning of waste into energy would create some more. And in future, off-grid communities will be filled with teleworkers, since wireless 4G internet will cost little and doesn't need infrastructure other than a phone mast. Wireless routers consume no more power than a light bulb. All over the developed world, there are small groups hoping and planning to build an off-grid village. It's a very difficult thing to do in the UK because the powers that be are dead against it. But we have found a possible site in Wales, and now we're looking for finance and pro bono help from lawyers, architects and house builders. Please contact me at nick@offgrid.net. If we don't raise the finance for this project, I'll be trying to build an off-grid township in the US, where far more live off-grid already and there is more money and more of a can-do spirit. Please, lawyers, architects, local authorities and house builders, get in touch. Help us realise this vision. Thanks for watching. That's been another episode of Off the Grid News.